The meeting of the Reading Municipal Light Board, RMLD, of commissioners is being videotaped at the RMLD office at 230 Ash Street. In fact, there's a remote control. We don't even have a video recorder here. They're doing it from the RCTV offices for distribution to the community television stations in Reading, North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items on the official agenda, as well as items not on the official agenda. We ask that all questions or comments from the public be directed to the chair, and that all parties, including members of the RMLD board, act in a professional and courteous manner when addressing the board or responding to comments. Once recognized by the chair, all persons addressing the board shall state their name and address prior to speaking. It's the role of the chair to maintain order in all public comment or ensuing discussion. And before we get going, we have some politics to take care of here. We have two members of the commissioners that I think are running for re-election, I believe. And I'll let each of them.
Mr. Chairman, I ask for a point of personal privilege.
You got it.
Okay. I wish to announce tonight that I am a candidate for re-election. I have been on this board for 32 years. I have a lot of knowledge. I still feel there's more I can add in the next 3 years. So we're officially announcing tonight that I will be starting my campaign to run for election in April. So
congratulations. Okay. Hope you can go for 35, if that's okay for me to say. I'm not sure.
Okay.
Is that okay for me to say that? I hope you can. Yeah, Dave?
Yeah. I mean, I'm also seeking re-election, but we don't need to take up the meeting with any more on that. But thank you for giving me that chance.
Okay. Okay. And Tom, you wanted to say that you're going to be running for re-election in 2 years, right?
Is that yes.
All right. We also have the CAB member, the chair of the board of the CAB, George Hooper.
No. Well, I am actually not the chair this year.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh. Sorry about that. Seeking re-election.
I guess I'm over.
Did you say ever?
Well, thank you.
And Dave Talbot, you'll be secretary today, I hope.
Certainly, thank you.
Thank you. And we'd like to also welcome Vanessa Alvarado from the Select Board. Thank you for coming, Vanessa, liaison. And Mark Doxer as well from the Finance Committee. Thank you for attending. Mm-hmm. Okay, public comment. Do we have any public comment? Doesn't seem that we do, but we do have the Citizens Advisory Board comments. I don't know if you have anything, George, you want to comment on?
No, I mean, we had our meeting last night. It was just a review. Hamid gave a great presentation, which I believe he's giving tonight.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I would have.
It was so good you wanted to come back and see it again.
For a second time.
Yeah.
For a second time. But I would have been interested in how you guys made out today with the storm. I know the winds were out there, and Woburn was experiencing some outages, and a few other areas were so.
Yeah, I was thinking about the storm today. I was wondering if we ever lost power while you were having these meetings, and how that would be ironic if that ever happened in this building. Because of happened.
Not that I know.
All right, liaisons to the RMLD board. Any comments from Mark or Vanessa? Okay.
Okay.
All right. And we already said there's no public comment. Okay. So we want to. Somebody want to make a motion to approve the minutes?
I'll move that the Board of Commissioners approve the meeting minutes of October 18th, 2018, and November 29th, 2018, and the recommendation of the General Manager.
Second.
Okay. Discussion. All those in favor? Motion carries 5-0-0. Okay. And the RMLD board member attendance at the Citizen Advisory Board, that was Dave Talbot, which was just yesterday, right, Dave?
Yes, that was yesterday. I remember it well, and George was there, and George has just provided us a brief report, and I don't have anything to add unless George wants to. It was a good meeting and good discussion.
Okay. And now we have the status of the payment to the town of Reading, and I'd like to read a little statement. We, all the select board members here attended all the commissioners attended the SLA Select Board meeting, and we'd like to make a statement, a reaction to that, and even a motion. So, as a bridge, while the RMLD studies how it can continue to help the town of Reading financially, the RMLD commissioners have proposed that the RMLD freeze the voluntary below-the-line payment that it makes to the town of Reading at the 2018 level of $2.48 million and change, 506, for 2 years, i.e. 2019 and 20. In the spirit of the Town of Reading's Board of Selectmen, or the Select Board, presented to the RMLD Board of Commissioners with a draft called the Agreement Regarding Distribution of Earnings of RMLD to Reading. The draft contract was very helpful in confirming that a freeze of the voluntary below-the-line payment at the 2018 level would be satisfactory while RMLD studies and determines a strategy for moving forward. However, our legal counsel has advised us that the use of a contract to document an obligation to pay an amount that is legally recognized as voluntary, a voluntary payment subject to available funds, is not appropriate or consistent with how such matters are handled by municipalities. The RMLD is happy that it can continue to help the town financially and looks forward to working with the Town of Reading to continue to do so by determining the appropriate formula to be used starting in 2021 for such voluntary payments. Tonight, we would like to formally vote on the amount of the voluntary payment. Note, based on the above, we recommend that the subcommittee fade away a little bit unless it was necessary to bring that subcommittee back in the future. The motion that the Board of Commissioners direct the RMLD to make certain voluntary payments to the Town of Reading from available below-the-line unappropriated earned surplus for the calendar years of 2019 and 2020 as follows. One, each payment shall total $2,480,506 and be paid semi-annually in installments as follows. $1,240,253 on June 30th, 2019, the same amount on December 31st, 2019, the same amount on June 30th, 2020, and again, $1,240,253 on December 31st, 2020. So four equal payments over the next 2 years. In the event that RMLD's below-the-line unappropriated earned surplus is insufficient to make the full payment to the Town of Reading or is otherwise required for RMLD to meet the franchise obligations in a particular calendar year, the RMLD Board of Commissioners may vote to reduce the amount of one or both such annual payments. Second. All right. Discussion?
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
All right. Mr. Chairman, I'm opposing this motion. I feel that we need to have some sort of memorandum of understanding that's written so that all parties understand, all future parties, all present and future parties. First off, you know, when you say to dismiss, you know, to fade away, actually, I think, you know, that particular note should say the present subcommittee to be dismissed.
I would change that, see
that we're doing away with that committee forever.
Okay. Present subcommittee to be dismissed. Okay.
Right, present.
I will make that change.
But I also feel that, you know, we should have some sort of memorandum of understanding between both this board and also the select board that actually puts in writing what each of us obligations are, and so it's clear to future boards. I mean, who knows? Maybe we're not all here 2 years from now. Maybe not all the select board is here 2 years from now. I do feel that is something that we should do, and I am intending to vote against this motion. That's my intent, is to vote against this. I also feel that, you know, and the selectmen had an item they added that if for some reason future, you know, kilowatt sales increase, you know, who knows? Maybe we get a marijuana growing fat warehouse that has 1 million square feet that will use a lot of electricity. You know, maybe that would come in and, you know, actually increase our kilowatt sales. I don't know if the town would be too crazy about that, but I feel that's not included and that's not addressed in this motion at all, and I feel it's something that we should do. That is my opinion, and I'm intending to vote against this motion.
Thanks for sharing that. Yeah, John.
Let me make just a few comments. I would disagree with Mr. Pacino on both cases. One is, I believe that doing a motion gives us all parties exactly what they wanted. All the numbers are the same. Nothing has changed in that. Part of the issue with what the Board of Selectmen had given to us and what we were going to give back to you is a legal document, multi-page, that states chapter and verse of why we have to do what we do, incurring significant attorney fees, and I can guarantee, almost guarantee, that everyone is going to be involved in wordsmithing that document down to the last possible word. And it's going to go back and forth for 1 month, 2 months, 6 months, who knows how long, and no one's going to be happy with it. Whereas we can do a motion, everybody gets exactly what they want, everything what we've all agreed upon going forward, and I think that the motion recognizes the fact that we are empowered to do that, and it gives everyone what they need. As far as the future kilowatt hour increases, I think that's making promises that we can't keep. We don't know if the kilowatt hours are going to go up, and even if they did within a six-month period of time, we've been going down for over 4 years, and correct me if I'm wrong, four, maybe even 5 years, we've been decreasing. So if something went up in a six-month period of time, would that then dictate that we should increase the amount that we'd be paid to Reading? I don't think you can determine a long-term trend by one data point. So you'd have to kind of average it over another 2 to 3 years. So rather than get into this very ambiguous language, I say we deal with it as it happens. And as it happens, we'll take a look at it, we'll make a determination. We're all trying to serve the best interest of all the communities here, and that's just my opinion.
Okay, thank you. Others? Other comments? Yeah, Todd?
Yeah, so I have maybe a little different perspective. It's more of a timing issue. So I think the reality is the goals, I think, are to have security of funding for the town for a period of time, which was set at 2 years, to allow us to come up with a new formula. And then the second goal is to come up with that new formula. I think the value of the motion is it allows us to solidify that, and then also, to me, as part of the formula process, we need to come up and memorialize a letter of understanding or intent or whatever we want to call it, but that would be the timing. I am concerned, there's no blaming here, that we all agree that this has been an arduous process. There's been a lot of discoveries, a lot of data. That's what this process takes. But I fear that if we try to memorialize a document at this stage, we're doing it at the risk and sacrifice of coming up with a formula, which is the end game here, so we can proceed and also give us the opportunity to, give the town some direction as well, because I think we all appreciate the need for town to run their business, and we're trying to do the same. So I'd also say, I don't know that we want to address, I guess I'm in John's camp in terms of additional revenues. I mean, the whole idea of the 2 years, we set the payment at a fixed number that we felt was reasonable, recognizing that we needed time to digest this. And the reality is there's other issues at play. We have uncertainties with the kilowatt hours. We also have to, which we haven't done, we need to understand better what we face with the ratepayers, not just in Reading, but also the other served towns, and what's happening there and the needs there, and that might also increase infrastructure needs as well. So reminding all of us, we serve Reading, we also serve three other communities who represent one in particular represents a significant load, being Wilmington, for our MLD. So I just would summarize, I say, I think all we're trying to do here, I think, with that motion is agree to move forward. As far as needing something in writing, I think we've made payments for 20 years continuous. Is that right, Colin? So I think there's history that, there's not an intent to shirk. So putting something in writing on that, to me, is kind of moot. I mean, want to help the town, we recognize the history and all the rest of it, but I'd rather see us get to business on getting a formula and also then memorializing whatever's appropriate for everybody's sake.
Mm-hmm. Good. Dave?
Just to be clear, you made the motion and then John seconded it?
He did.
That happened, okay. I basically what Tom said I would generally concur with. I mean, what I was made to understand is that an agreement is not how municipalities and municipal utilities typically execute a payment, and so if that's not how it works, then we wouldn't want to break with how things are done elsewhere in the Commonwealth. But that what we do want to do is ensure. enshrine the actual two-year payment at the levels we've been discussing and get that done so that we voted as a board, okay, this is what's going to happen for sure. And then, as Tom said, you know, the next step is to devise the formula. So, you know, Phil's suggestion that, well, what if there's a big new load that increases kilowatt-hour sales? Well, if that's the formula, we haven't developed that formula yet. That's what we're going to do over the next 2 years. So that isn't something that we would be able to address at this point. Maybe that is the formula, and that's what we're going to be working on. But to me, we're voting for this payment, which is the certainty, the 2 years at these levels, and we're getting that done. So hopefully that does put this to rest. Hopefully the subcommittee has been adjourned as in its present form, and now we can move on with devising a new formula and many other types of business that we want to be doing to make RMLD grow and help the community after this is behind us.
Yes,
for now.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just will qualify something as I would understand
sure.
it. So
yeah.
It may be true that other municipalities don't use that mechanism of a contract, but I'm not sure that matters, because even if they don't, you know, that's something we could decide to do, and maybe some already do it. But I think as I understand it from the legal side of it, is that this is a voluntary payment, so memorializing a contract on a voluntary payment sort of changes the nature of the
It's not voluntary
payment.
Anymore. Right,
so,
right.
So do we need a legal discussion on that at all?
Do you want to comment on that, Chris, from a legal point of view?
Come back to me first.
Oh, okay, go ahead. No.
Yeah. Okay, so I want everybody to have their say. You know, one of the things, the other thing that I'm concerned with here is there was a third party to this agreement, the CAB.
Well, I was going to ask for a clarification.
Sure.
I'm listening to you guys go back and forth, and one of the things was dissolving the subcommittee. So who's coming up with the formula? You know, once you guys eliminate this, so is and the CAB is just kind of sitting back, and
mm-hmm.
you guys are going to vote on this now and push it through. And I understand your point. For the community, it gives them a fixed price that they can use for budgetary numbers for the next 2 years.
Right.
But we have to come up with a pliable formula.
Mm-hmm.
So we do it. And actually, if I may. The formula is something that we're going to have experts on develop. No one here, except with the exception of perhaps Colleen, knows the kilowatt hour mechanisms well enough to actually come up with a formula other than what's been done elsewhere. We've actually done some studies on that. But to have an independent party take a look at what is reasonable under the circumstances that we're existing, it's not something that we can just, dial it up.
Absolutely.
So, and we can't solve this. The Board of Selectmen can't solve it. The Town of Reading can't solve it. So we need to sort of think about that, put in place whoever the expert might be, who might make a recommendation, which we might disagree with even at that point in time. But we need time to do that.
I think what you're saying is that we'd present any options to the cap.
Oh, absolutely.
Yes.
So
the other thing is, too, is it's just the present subcommittee that's being dismissed if this vote goes through.
Right.
Which I'm still going to vote against. But, the subcommittee, the mechanism still exists. And I would anticipate that if this goes through and then we come up with some sort of formula, we'd reformulate the subcommittee at that point.
I'm 100% in favor of reformulating a subcommittee when we all feel that it's necessary to do that.
Okay.
The present one has been perhaps not as effective as we all hope. And so, and with this vote, we really don't even need it.
So the other question I have is, under the 20-year agreement, the CAB has a right to, on any major decision. This is a major decision. Is the CAB got any kind of feeling on this at this point?
Well, we had a brief discussion on it last night. Just giving them an update. And, I think they're on a kind of wait and see how it goes through, too, because nobody has an idea of the formula, which way the RMLD is going. Of course, we're watching, the kilowatt sales kind of decline. So that's, sensitive to the town of Reading for the payment to it. So, but from below the line payment, we just want to make sure that it's fair for all. The thing that we're not looking to do is to increase rates to make payments. So sort of agreement does come through, I'd like to bring it back to the CAB so we can discuss it.
Yes, John, I can make one more comment, just one final comment. We're talking about the kilowatt hour sales declining, and that's absolutely true. It's just happening, and we've got the facts to show that. But don't forget, we're putting a massive amount of reinvestment back into the infrastructure of the system.
Absolutely.
To the tune of $8 million a year. We need to do that because we haven't done it for the last 20 years, and for whatever reason, it needs to be done now. Otherwise, the storms like tonight, the transformers would be blowing up everywhere, and we wouldn't have power or light in this room. So irrespective of anything, and that's why we have the clause in here that says if untoward events happen, or the substations blow up or whatever else, we can come back and use that money to basically rebuild our system. We are in the process of rebuilding the system, and I think it's a wonderful rebuild. I think that, you know, we've got experts now on staff, which perhaps weren't here in the past, to actually make that happen in a very logical way.
Oh, absolutely. I agree. Colleen and her staff have done a great job for reliability on the system, but catastrophic events do happen.
Yes.
Like Columbia Gas.
Oh, my God, yes.
I mean, not that,
yep.
you never know. So
never know.
We just need to be protected.
Okay.
I have a quick question, though, Wiz. As a matter of process, and I know the CAB will vote on our budget, so that we need their approval for our budget, right? They don't. Is that required for this particular?
My honest opinion is that
I think it does.
It does. This is a major decision under the 20-year agreement.
But I mean, is there a ground truth on this? Like, what's the answer to that under the 20-year agreement? Is the CAB supposed to have?
I mean, on this motion that
yes.
we're passing,
no.
is it not? We want to have them vote on it as
I mean,
well.
It's worth asking that now rather than later.
Chris,
know.
Do you have a comment on that?
Not yet.
Okay. All right. Do you have a comment, John, on that?
The one comment that I have is that I can remember in recent history is that when we tried to increase the rates here a couple of years ago because we felt we needed to increase the rates, I remember that the CAB said no. Everyone in the CAB said no.
We didn't want to increase at the time, but when we took the vote, I mean, for that rate, I believe there was some discussion, but it ended up passing.
Yeah, it did end up passing, and we passed it here as well.
Yeah.
So the question is, do we pass it here first, or does it go to the CAB?
I think it's supposed to be presented to the CAB first.
Okay.
As the recommendation
right.
from your Board of Commissioners. I believe that's your legal staff for that, but I believe that's correct.
You know, if you wanted to, Mr. Chair, you could add after the Board of Commissioners and just add a sentence subject to CAB approval.
I like that solution.
There's somebody that's planning for voting against it.
That's what you get when you
have the collaborative.
That's what you get when you have the chairman's life. The chairman of the bylaw committee.
But only if I'm sorry.
I will amend the motion to include Phil's.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Before you do that, I mean, only do that if it's indeed required. I mean, I'm only asking the question because it sort of came up and.
Yeah.
You know, we're not. This doesn't raise rates, and this doesn't change the budget.
And
so
in a way, it actually lowers.
It could
lowers
I mean,
the.
So it, I'm not clear on whether it's a threshold for CAB, but Chris is looking at it right now, so we could.
Yeah.
I think you know if you're going to vote the motion, I think just as a courtesy, it'd be a good thing to do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Subject to CAB approval if required, and then we could.
Yeah.
The if required part would get us.
But, you know, even as Phil says, just as a general courtesy,
yeah,
I don't see what it hurts us to put that in, even if it is not required. I think we can. Why not?
Sure.
Right.
I mean, it might delay it a month, but that doesn't matter because our next payment's not until.
Since I didn't hear any opposition, I will not speak for the other members of the board. But
it was
something here.
This is consistent with what the select board voted on. It's consistent with what your thinking
right.
is and our thinking.
And it was an uneventful CAB meeting last night. So.
Right.
I mean,
yeah, Tom?
Yeah, so I just want to make a couple of comments. So I'll speak personally, but I know I'm not the only one on the board. So most of us, we're all residents of the town of Reading. Some of us, 40 years or so for me and others. So I think it's really about each of us, select board has fiscal responsibilities to the town. We have obligations to the town as well. I think what we're trying to do, which is not easy, we're trying to come up with a solution. We have a business here, an enterprise that has, I think, produced reliable, responsive, cost-effective energy. I don't think anyone disagrees, but if they have, they
haven't lived in
other
some other towns. Yeah.
Sure. So we want to try to preserve that. I don't think I've missed a town meeting, so I know what's going on in the town of Reading, and Phil, you have more years in it than I do. So we understand those issues. But we also, and I think we've said this before, the town of Reading isn't served by us if we accomplish a bigger payment by changing the rates. And the cab certainly doesn't benefit. So I think our job is to try to come up to a solution. This, if I remember right, this is coming up on the second birthday of this issue. Over 2 years.
It's close to it, yeah.
So personally, and I know government business is slow, but we have to fix this. And to me, spending time trying to craft a document, which we've all, and I echo John's comments, it has to be done, but I don't want to spend 6 months crafting and changing whereases to their twos and howevers. And let's fix the problem. Let's get a formula.
No disrespect.
That we can live with and move on and memorialize whatever we need to memorialize. But again, for 20 years, we've lived together. I mean, we share resources. So, I mean, I think everybody's committed to cooperate here. But what came to light a year and three quarters ago is RMLD has issues just like the town has issues. So let's figure out a way to address them all, maybe get more economic growth, which I think we've sounded that bell enough, that could help everybody, all the towns, do more of what's being done in some of the other services.
And it could be part of the calculation for the payment to the town as well, right, if we grow because of the economic growth.
I personally don't think, I'm not saying it's a trivial motion, but I think the motion is really, to me, a catalyst to say, fine, we agree on 2 years. Now let's fix the problem and get to work on fixing that problem.
That's it.
Yep.
That's it right there in a nutshell.
You know, we have a couple. Go ahead.
I was going to ask for call vote, but if you wanted to ask.
Well, I just didn't know if anybody wanted, if Mark or Vanessa wanted to make a comment at this time. There's no. Okay. Okay. All right. Yes. And you were going to say?
I'd like to call for a vote.
I think we could do that. Okay. All those in favor, we're going to make two adjustments. We're going to make. Oh, yeah.
Was Chris going to say?
Oh, Chris has a comment.
Opinion from you.
Oh, Chris.
So your question is whether or not cap approval is required.
Yep.
Yes.
So the cap has, in the 20-year agreement, there's an attachment for it. There are two functions.
Do you want to step up to the mic so that?
Right. Yeah, sorry. Yeah. That was pretty quick, Chris, digging up that information.
Not bad, huh?
Just Chris Pollard is attorney.
So the cab has two functions under the 20-year agreement. Under attachment 4 to the 20-year agreement, it says that the cab shall have decision-making input into the following areas. There are five of them. Significant expansion or retirement of RMLD's transmission, distribution, general plant, or generation. That's not this. Power contracts and agreements in their mix. Not this. Cost of service and rate-making practices. It's not a practice. Financial and accounting practices. No. And other issues that may come before the board. That's pretty broad, pretty general.
That was intended to be pretty broad.
Yeah.
So, you know, depending on what your past practice and custom is, if this is the type of question or type of issue that you would normally take before the cab to seek their advisory input on, then that's probably something that should be done on a going forward basis. And the second is a mandatory thing that the cab does, and that's the advisory board shall review the itemized operating capital budget of the RMLD and may recommend increases, decreases, or alterations to the budget. But this is not an itemized budget. So at this point, I think what we have is that other issues come before the board, which would trigger the advisory role for the cab.
And I think, Phil, your solution was a good one. Why don't we just put it in there, subject to the citizen advisory
board?
I think
you could accept that as part of the main motion if the seconder agrees.
If what?
You could accept that as part of the main motion if the seconder agrees.
Do you have a seconder? Yeah. Does somebody second?
Yes, I agree.
Yeah. You did. Okay, so let's add that in. And then we're changing the language, also your recommendation, Phil, that this subcommittee be dismissed. And you could say at some time in the future
right,
it could be.
I just think that's part of that. I don't think we're voting on that.
Well, I guess that's just a statement. Yeah, that's right.
At some point, I think town at the right time, maybe, but
You're right. That's
I believe in subcommittees, but it feels like, you know, we should reconstitute or do something. But I think it's not part of the motion.
It isn't part of the motion. You're right. Okay. So I think we can take a vote.
Do you mind rereading the
it's pretty long. No, I'll do it again. All right.
Well, 2 years.
I'll do it. Okay. That the Board of Commissioners direct the RMLD.
No, subject to the CAB approval. Got it.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Right. Thank you. That the Board of Commissioners, subject to the CAB approval, direct the RMLD to make certain voluntary payments to the Town of Reading from available below the line unappropriated earned surplus for the calendar years 2019 and 2020 as follows. One, each annual payment shall total $2,480,506 and be paid on semi-annual installments as follows: $1,240,253 on these four dates: June 30th, 2019, December 31st, 2019, June 30th, 2020, and the last payment of $1,240,253 on December 31st, 2020. Second, in the event RMLD's below-the-line unappropriate earned surplus is insufficient to make the full annual payment to the Town of Reading or is otherwise required for the RMLD to meet its franchise obligations in a particular calendar year, the RMLD Board of Commissioners may vote to reduce the amount for one or both such annual payments. All those...
So just with that addition to the amendment, I guess just a point of clarification. So if the CAB decided to vote against it, what's the outcome there?
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
So the Citizens Advisory Board in this instance is advisory. So here their job would be to review and comment and provide comments to you. So there isn't actually an approval role. You consult, review, let them look at it, they give their comments back to you, you consider their comments, and then you move on and make your decision.
Okay.
So is that the practical implications of that is we vote this tonight, the CAB comes back and votes it down.
You would come back to us again.
We come back again
more discussion.
Revote?
Potentially.
But if they agree, it just continues on as we...
But point of clarification, the CAB doesn't have the right to vote yes or no. They have the right to review and provide you with comment.
Okay, so we could do something new with their advice, is what
you're
saying.
Correct.
It's our decision.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, what does your addition say? Subject to the, it says subject to CAB approval, though. What does the amendment say?
So it should be subject to the CAB's advice and
advice.
Review and comment.
Review and comment.
Review and
so,
review
sorry,
and
do I have to read it all again?
Or following.
Yeah, one more time.
So it's subject to the Citizens Advisory Board's review and comment,
yes.
Is really that the language is, Tracy. John really wants a vote.
Well, I mean, you should ask Colleen. She has a comment.
Yeah. Colleen, do you have any comment on this before we vote?
No.
You don't?
No.
Okay. All those in favor?
Thank you.
Okay. It's 4-1.
All those opposed?
All those opposed.
Let my name show in the record. I ask that all the names show in the record, please.
All right. Mm-hmm. 4-1.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Chris.
And I ask that, Mr. Chairman, I request that this document, once it's cleaned up, be made part of the official record.
Absolutely. You've got it.
As I also request that the original document the selectman presented to us be made part of the original, the original record.
So,
the official
record.
The selectman's agreement they sent to us.
Yeah, and what else?
No, and then
our
document here will be made part of the official
motion
record. With the motion and also the explanation.
The statement and the motion.
And the motion.
Okay.
Once cleaned up.
And the select board.
And the select board.
What they sent to us. Okay.
Be part of the official record.
So we don't have, again, 2 more years.
Yeah.
So what is the process? Maybe that is a final step for the subcommittee. What is the process to get information back to the town? Obviously, we have representatives here, but I mean, we should assume that, I mean, I think an appropriate protocol would be to reconnect with the select board and
yeah.
that
Come on up.
Thank you. I would just suggest sending it to our town manager, who can then forward your motion to the rest of the board, and I'll give an update at our next meeting.
Okay. Thank you very much, Vanessa. We really appreciate that.
Okay.
We'll do that. Okay, next we have, it's the discussion on the RMLD Renewable Energy Supply Reporting. Dave, you want to start this discussion?
Yeah, this is a couple of interesting things to talk about. One of them is a very interesting proposed piece of legislation that the Municipal Electric Association of Massachusetts has come up with to make sure that municipal light plants are reducing greenhouse gas emissions and are, really digging in and doing a lot to meet the state's goals in that front. And relatedly, and Chuck might get up and say something subject to Colleen's direction, but, and with that, there's a little housekeeping matter that there's a form that we will be filing with respect to an optional form with our greenhouse gas emissions. To make sure that we're reporting all the things to the state that we should and that we can report. That's just a housekeeping matter, if Colleen wants to address that, and then Chuck, talk about this exciting proposed legislation.
Colleen?
Actually, I'll just turn it over to Chuck. He can actually talk about both. It'll be the filings come out of his, we just recently filed with MCAN for the greenhouse gas emissions for the entire state, so we're pretty active in this whole concept, and we did a lot of work to help with this legislation, so pretty proud of it. Having worked collaboratively with all 42 municipals, it was pretty good when you can herd all those cats together,
yeah,
you know?
Sure, so. Yeah, that's great. All right, Chuck, you gonna start with Dave's, or you gonna start with the thing that Colleen was just talking about?
The legislation can be...
Go ahead.
Covered fairly quickly. The legislation that was introduced is structured so that Chapter 164, which defines the independence of the municipal light plants here in the Commonwealth, is left sacrosanct and untouched. In exchange, the municipal light plants in Massachusetts, all of them, for the first time, I believe, in the history of the Commonwealth, have agreed to develop portfolios that approach carbon-free, reduced carbon emissions. And they have target goals over the next few years. The first is 2021 at 7%. And as they produce these, they will be reporting to the Department of Environmental Protection on their efforts across the board. And the systems have a mechanism in there where any of them who for whatever reason fail to meet in the target year that amount will put funds into an account that will be used for compliance down the road. So there's sort of an enforcement mechanism, if you will, built into that. And this avoids the issues around how you define the purchase of RECs and renewable energy, and it simply says we're targeting carbon-free, which is the goal anyway. So this was introduced by Representative Golden in the House. Representative Golden is from Middlesex. Middlesex does not have an MLP in its service territory. So this is a comprehensive effort. We're going to have to see how it plays out. One thing that the legislation incorporates is that nuclear units will be counted in the municipal's compliance with carbon-free, non-carbon generation. And so it looks like this is something that everyone is on board with and we think is going to be advantageous to the MLPs and the Commonwealth in whole. So
very collaborative effort. Sounds we're pleased then, huh?
Yes. We even had Energy New England and MWEC sitting at the same table. I think somebody took a picture of the two of them sitting next to each other. That's how collaborative this effort has been. And for those who don't know, MWEC and Energy New England have not always seen eye to eye on the conduct of affairs in the wholesale market for public power systems.
Mm-hmm.
So we're kind of excited about this.
That's great.
And moving it forward, it's my understanding that RMLD was one of the leaders in the early stages of developing this initiative and pushing for it. So I believe that was Colleen that was
nicely done,
involved
Colleen.
In that effort. So.
And on the other matter, that the small housekeeping matter, that these forms, the AQ31 and AQ32, the optional and the mandatory to the DEP, is something that we're going to make sure we're filing with the state.
Yes, the issue was recently brought to my attention. I'm sort of the new kid on the block, so I don't have immediate responses to these things, but I am going to look into the history of the reporting and see if I can address or uncover any issues that there may be with the reporting. And then for the optional reporting, I will acquire the 2017 forms, get those completed, get those filed. 2018 is not quite due yet. I believe June or so is the due date for that. But we will make sure that both the mandatory and the optional reports are filed with DEP.
Great. Excellent. Thank you, Chuck.
Thanks very much, Chuck and Colleen.
Appreciate it, Chuck. Okay. All right. Colleen, this is the General Manager Report. It's over to you.
Thank you. Chris is going to help me out a little bit on this. If you want to go up, I'll hit some of the ones that are a little bit less complicated. So we're down, I think, after this, I think we're only down to just a small handful left of policies. Well, as a matter of fact, we've already hit that mark. So I think I had asked prior to say that, you know, before some of these policies hadn't been looked at in 20 years or so. And so when I started doing them, we put a revision date of every 3 years because I think it's with laws changing, it seemed like a healthy way to do it. But if there's no changes, what I was proposing is, so we have two or three of them that are coming up, they're not on this agenda, that I would just send them to you, say there's no change, no recommendation, we'd just vote to, like, extend them, and we'd date them. So that's how we'll just keep it going. So unless there's any comments on them or changes or laws, Chris will keep an eye on them, they'll just keep rolling forward, okay? Those are for those. So I'll present those next time. For tonight, though, we have Policy 8 on the OPEB Trust Fund, Policy Number 18 on the Strategic Plan, 22 on the Pensions Trust, and Policy 23 on the Dress Standards. So try to do some easy ones first. You've all gotten copies of these policies. The dress code is essentially, it's been reduced from a number of pages down to just a single, and basically, it's bringing us in line with dress standards that are acceptable out there within the office area. It's business casual, and a lot of the dress standards for the utility are also in the collective bargaining agreements. So for flame retardant clothing and things that PPE. Protective equipment and stuff like that is all established. It's reiterated in this dress code, but it's really to establish more of what's appropriate in a business office and to also remind everyone that even if you work in a business, if you were to go out to the warehouse, you'd have to
dress appropriately for that environment, even if you were taking a tour or just going to take a look. I think the dress standard came out well. We did a lot of checking, a lot of different places. You would think that this one would be easy. I thought it was going to be easy. It can get interesting. So I'm pleased to recommend a request to update, approve policy 23 on the dress code.
Yes. Phil.
Yeah, I just have one. In the first paragraph, we use the word et cetera. That seems kind of broad. Where we talk about the ARC flash study, et cetera.
That's just because your ACT flash study has to do with what level of energy and what level of flame retardant clothing that you need. We have so many safety-related policies like OSHA and ACT flash. I mean, I would take paragraphs to try to write them all up that have to do with safety.
Wouldn't it be more appropriate to say in other applicable standards?
Where are you referring to?
I'm in the first paragraph.
The first paragraph.
It's the fourth line. You see where they say ARC flash study, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
That could be John Stempec's, you know, dress code. Wouldn't it be better to say other applicable standards or other as applicable standards?
I don't have an issue with that.
They're not all standards. Like your collective bargaining agreement's not a standard. You have policies and procedures. You got regulations, standards. I mean, we could say other applicable
requirements.
Procedures or requirements
for
the task at hand. I mean, it is getting a little difficult. This is the whole issue of wordsmithing, right?
I know.
That works.
Yes. Sure.
Okay.
Colleen, I know you did a good, I think our company dress code policy is like 6 pages, so you did a good job. but it's a tough one. Maybe this is covered by virtue of is there a need to, and maybe this is for Chris as well, is there a need to have a statement in terms of the what's the outcome of policy violations? Is it a disciplinary action, or do we need to tie it to, because clearly we made clear what isn't appropriate or acceptable, but how do we address violations in that?
We could add a sentence, violations of this policy or something.
I mean, we don't list those down on every policy. If you break a policy, a lot of them have to do with what policy you're breaking. If you come in wearing something, I'm going to send you.
I'm not looking for specific.
Yeah.
It's more, if violations will be dealt with accordance to the RMLD's disciplinary process or something.
I just don't think we have that sentence at the end of every policy is what I'm saying. So you're expected as an employee to follow policies. If something is safety related, it's going to be a severe, disciplining under progressive discipline. If you just come in and you have a micro skirt on, you probably will get sent home. So there's a difference. But I'm just saying, at the end of every policy, we don't. It's not an employee handbook, so that
right.
we say.
Yeah, but so for example, it wouldn't be appropriate for the OPM policy. You don't need a employee disciplinary action, but. I guess the point is, playing devil's advocate, if I'm an employee and, I've read the policy and I come in with the wrong shirt on and I get disciplined, I would say, what the heck, I understand this is not acceptable, but, why are you disciplining me? I don't know how it works here. I just think that's something to consider for policies that have to do with expected employee behavior. But if it's...
We can add, where it says, and I tried to capture that without getting into, negotiating progressive discipline. In addition to being a violation of this policy, some non-compliance with this policy may also be considered a safety violation. So I think it's understood that if you violate a policy, you're going to there's going to be progressive discipline. So, but if it's safety related, it's going to be even more. So
I think it's difficult to cover just everything. That's where the issue that you have here. For example, I don't even know what jeggings are. next, ne- next year there might be, you know, something new that comes out that's athleisure related, and we don't, you know, it's not covered under the policy. So I think there has to be a certain amount of discretion given to the general manager to make that determination. From a safety perspective, that's a no-brainer, obviously. From an appearance perspective, I don't know. I mean, some of those are more subjective. I mean, look at IBM in the old days, right? It was blue suit, white shirt, and tie, and if you didn't wear that, you were fired. I mean, you were, you know, not promoted. There were very sort of informal ways of dealing with you. So I don't know how one addresses absolutely everything under the sun. So maybe it's you know, with the something such as the discretion of the general manager that I don't want to say it finds things offensive. Again, we're here wordsmithing this. I don't mean to do that. So I'm looking for your input. That to Phil's point, the third paragraph also has an et cetera at the end of it. And I think that one for the location should be perhaps something like other areas that the general manager deems appropriate. In other words, it could be on a truck. It could be in the back of a truck. It could be, you know, wherever there might be some safety issue, right, that you're trying to address. And I mean, et cetera does cover it, but maybe that's what you're trying to tell us. I take it back.
we could say, or anything that looks, smells, or feels like a field environment. So we're just trying to give some examples, and in fact, this bulleted list is really just giving some examples of your office environment general category.
Well, maybe if you just included the such as, you know, this would include such as, da-da-da-da-da, et cetera, so that it gives you the room, because this would include sounds definitive. The et cetera at the end makes it open-ended. I'm not trying, again, I'm not trying to take up any more time on this than is necessary, but because we all know what you're trying to do.
Right.
We're just trying to make it maybe a little bit more definitive.
Yeah, just a closing comment. My point is that it's very difficult to policy like this because it is a big part of this is you know it when you see it kind of thing, right, in terms of it's appropriate in certain dress codes, but I'd make a general statement on policy. If there's an expectation for behavior for an employee, and we have the policy, which is good, no policy is bad, right? The policy also should have some indication, and doesn't have to be every instance of the universe. I'm just saying right now, as it stands, the policy does not address what happens when you violate it, and I think that's a fundamental thing we should at least be concerned about, because if I'm an employee, I could say, your policy says it's a violation, but there's no indication. You know, you've just suspended me. You know, what the heck, right? So I think there's value in having that, but I'll conclude my input.
How about if I may I speak?
Yeah.
So in the second to the last sentence there, I can say violations can result in progressive discipline up to and including termination.
Mm-hmm.
That's the
perfect
standard language I'm used to seeing.
All right. So, what does that leave us? Are we changing anything else? Are we good?
We will put in on any other applicable standards. I can change visit a temporary field site, a garage, a warehouse, or any other field-like environment
okay.
instead of et cetera.
Okay.
Right. Yep.
If we make those three changes, I think
okay.
we're good, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Subject to cab review.
I think George really doesn't want to do this. All right.
The next one.
Woo. We're moving right ahead.
This is going to dress code.
Here we go.
Well, you asked us to look them over, not overlook them.
Okay, the OPEB one, policy number 8, very simple. Statutory changes in 2011 rendered the policy out of date. It's been revised to reflect current laws and GASB requirements. That's about it.
Okay. So, yes.
So, just a question. Am I right, Chris, in saying that the policy as written reflects the most up-to-date are some supporting documentation thoughts around, because I have the same concern about custodial responsibility. So I was trying to understand whether your comments were reflected completely in this document.
Yes, they are.
They are. Okay, because I thought...
For OPEB.
What?
For OPEB, yes.
Okay. But with regard to the comments here about who should be appointed custodian, and that I thought there were some other recommendations that were made on that.
Not on the OPEB side. So on the OPEB side, there was a change to the law in 2011, which, as Colleen said, it rendered the policy out of date. So what we did is we just simply updated the OPEB policy to be consistent with the 2011 law.
Which is the most common.
No, it's not. There's a Municipal Modernization Act that came in after that. But there's a provision of that law that allows pre-existing OPEB plans to continue to operate under the 2011
plan.
Is
it in our best interest to do that versus the most current?
Well, when I worked with Colleen on this, and you know, the fundamental question was, are you happy with your OPEB program as it's running now?
Sure.
And Wendy was involved, and the answer was yes. This is working well through the town of Reading, and that's running through the 2011 statute. So what we did is made some minor changes to the policy to make it consistent with the 2011 law.
Okay. So the only thing I would say, I just did one very minor friendly change. So responsibilities needs to be changed, the spelling on it. So I know we're listing them. So is there any, in a case like this, Chris, where the town treasurer is actually called out with responsibilities, I mean, what does that mean in terms of their accountability?
It's all handled statutorily.
Yeah. Okay, but do we need any understanding from the town that that's their responsibility? And
no, I don't think you do in this policy, no. Because you, under the 2011 law, you have the right to designate the town as the custodian of your funds, and then once the custodian, they have statutory obligations that they have to.
I'm assuming somewhere there's a call out of the town's responsibilities.
Correct.
The only other last comment, the final comment, I guess I just wonder, it talks about the funding schedule shall reduce the unfunded actuarial liability of other post-employment benefits to zero. I mean, sounds like a hypothetical
It's actually happening by statute.
Right.
The way that the amount of money that's determined that the RMLD has to pay on an annual basis includes that pay down of unfunded liabilities, which is scheduled to be completely funded by 2030.
Okay, I thought that was sort of a rolling date, though. It's five. It just seemed like we were suggesting something that was, you know.
It's supposed to happen.
Okay, I thought the last finance.
No, it's a function of what the interest rates are, though. That's the problem. It's a function of what the interest rates are, and it changes every year.
I'm not a finance expert, but we said it in the annual review. Yeah. Okay. Robbie, do you think it's going to make it in 2030?
I have no idea. I mean, it really depends on what the interest rates are.
Yeah.
If the interest rates go up, then we'll definitely make it.
Right.
They go down, it means we can't get that kind of return on it. They go down to 1%, we can't get that return on it, and nobody can get return on the money.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's going to be in the same boat. All of America is struggling with these pension funding.
Okay. We good on that one?
Yeah.
All right, Colleen, next.
So this is just very simple revision update to what was already there. It's basically saying that we will set out with our mission and vision statements, and we will go into a 20-year plan, and that we will keep it up to date at least every 3 years. Now, so it's just a general directive of having a strategic plan. The RMLD did one in 2008.
Mm-hmm.
It was done by a consultant. They asked questions of different people. Actually, the standard way of doing strategic planning within corporations is that your generals or your directors do them, because they're establishing and having a buy-in into what the objectives are, okay? So I think I mentioned before, we were fortunate enough to have Mike Prisco, who's the chairman of the North Reading Select Board. He used to do strategic planning all the time for the military. He's done it for a number of towns, a number of different companies. He came on his own time and helped facilitate. We had just hired Chuck. We have Ronnie Holzer, who's helping us up in IT. So we had everyone there. We're all
he
peers.
Did it on his own time. He
did his own time.
We didn't have
to help
pay
us.
Him to do that.
No. He wanted to help us. Mm-hmm. I had met with him and asked him if he would. Mm-hmm. And so he ran a great training program, did you think, Chuck? And it's going to take us a few sessions to go with it.
Mm-hmm.
But to speak to maybe some of the questions that Dave had last night, governing policies govern policies. And so you're not going to create a strategic plan that goes against what you have written as a policy, right? We develop objectives from there. So we're all taking a shot at kind of revitalizing the mission and vision. And we'll write the objectives, and we're actually going to update it every year. But we'll go through the SWOT analysis, and it'll be very comprehensive, but it'll only be about 7 or 8 pages long. And then it'll be in a draft form, and we'll make a presentation to you guys and the CAB, and everyone can have input. It's not something that we're going to be running, you know, we're not going to all develop it on regular sessions.
The first time you do it is the toughest time. Incremental things that you do to the strategic plan, what you're talking about, becomes much easier.
Correct. Right.
I'm just saying,
it's like, you know, you're listing your objectives. You every year you update with your progressions. It's a strategic plan, but I also had tried to set the budget by taking the budget and make it into 6 years. It was my way of helping to show the objectives and having your input on the objectives even going forward in the absence of what I consider to be a conventional strategic plan. So you kind of already get an idea of how I would do strategic planning. You take all of your core values, whether you're talking about your renewable portfolio or anything that has to do with running this business, will all be in there in all the objectives, including how we treat the customer. Everything like that will be there. And I think you'll appreciate it when it's done, and we'll be looking forward to your comments. So all this policy says is that we should have one.
Mm-hmm.
You want me to use standard methods to do it, and you want me to make sure that it's updated every 3 years. So that's all this policy says.
Okay. Comments by anybody?
Just a very minor one. Under the SWOT, I would just make that plural, strengths and weaknesses.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, that is the definition of SWOT.
Okay. Actually, I'm making a change myself. It should be SWOT with 2 T's. It's strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, threats, and trends.
Oh, I haven't heard about the extra T on SWOT.
So.
Excellent. When do you think you'll have it done? The policy. I mean, not the policy, obviously. It's just when do you think you'll...
A couple months?
Yeah.
You think?
Sometime in the spring?
We have our second meeting's next week, so.
Spring-ish.
Yeah. Sometime
All right.
in the spring.
Good. Okay. Is there one last here?
There is one last. And
yeah.
That okay. We're going to vote them all?
We're going to vote them all at once. There's one more. Yeah.
Make the motion whenever you're ready.
Okay. Sure. Thanks.
All right. The last one is the pension trust policy 22, and I'm going to have Chris talk about that because it's a little bit more involved.
So the pension trust at RMLD dates back to 1966. In 1966, the Commonwealth used a pay-as-you-go funding method in which contributions were based on current retirement costs. At that time, the RMLD established the pension trust, which, as I said, was in 66. And that was in order to recover through its rates amounts necessary to reduce RMLD's unfunded pension liabilities, which weren't covered with the pay-as-you-go program. However, due to changes in law, RMLD's annual payments now take into account its unfunded pension liabilities. With that, because of the change in law, it's rendered the whole policy don't need the trust anymore. So our recommendation is that instead of putting new money into the pension trust, that you take your money out, you pay it out on a annual basis as you're supposed to. Once all the money is drained out by the terms of the trust itself, the trust will lapse, and then at that point I would recommend that you vote to get rid of this policy, and then you're covered by statute at that point. You make your annual payments to PERAC, and that's all you have to do. And it's operating costs that you recover in your rates, just like any other operating costs that you've got.
Questions for Chris on this?
So just to clear, because the motion actually has it in that we adopt something under policy 22. You're saying that we shouldn't really adopt anything today. We use up the funds that are in the trust. Okay, so that really should come out of the motion.
So we're just discussing this. We're not actually voting on it.
On this particular policy, 22.
22.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we don't need to vote.
We are ready.
Okay.
Thank you, Chris.
You're welcome.
I assume we're not doing 26, 29, and 30.
That's correct.
Okay.
We're just doing 8, 18,
okay.
And 23.
So move that the Board of Commissioners approve the changes to Policy 8, OPEB Trust Fund, Policy 19.
18,
excuse me. Which one did we change? We changed. Make sure I know I'm on the same page. Okay. Policy 18, strategic plan as adjusted, and policy 23, dress standards as adjusted.
Second.
We made changes
to
both of those. Yeah.
Discussion.
Recommendation, General Manager.
Yeah,
excuse me.
On the registers. Okay. Discussion. I think we already had discussion. And all those in favor? Motion carries 500. Good to have you back.
I never was. <heard that. laughs> This is a democracy.
I'm just kidding.
Express my opinion.
All right. So now we want to talk about the Next Era Energy Marketing Public Power Summit.
Yes.
You're going on a trip?
Yeah, I actually went last year, but I didn't submit it because I kind of had doubled it up with a personal trip.
Is that the one that was D.C. last year? Is that right?
No, D.C. is the APPA.
Okay.
To meet with the, I'm actually going to correct that. But so I went to the Next Era. It was one of the best networking I'd ever been to. The training was fantastic. They're going to do a little bit more for me again this year. They gave me trading floor tours, and it was pretty phenomenal. So it's just a couple of days, and pretty cheap to fly down there,
mm-hmm.
and they're charging me a registration fee this year, so it seemed a little bit more, appropriate to ask. Even though you let me go last year, I didn't submit it, but I mean, I'm going to submit it this year. So.
Okay, all right. We can read the motion and then we can ask him any comments. Go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. Move that the Board of Commissioners approve Ms. O'Brien's travel to and attendance at the Next Era Energy Marketing Public Power Summit. Going to mispronounce this, Manapalin, Florida, from February 3rd through February 7th, 2019.
I think you pronounced it perfectly.
Second.
Okay.
Second.
Just
right.
One comment, Mr. Chair,
yes.
That this is required under the general manager's contract. That we approve your travel out of state.
Okay. And discussion.
Where is that in Florida? I have no clue.
It's down, Next Era is like, it's down near Fort Lauderdale.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Yep.
Client that has a mansion there.
Really?
Yes.
I think that is Sunday. That's Super Bowl Sunday.
Yeah. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
Okay. She might be doing a hop to Atlanta from there later that night. I don't know. We'll see. Yeah, that's the day she's traveling.
Is it okay if I change that to the 6th? I actually get back the 6th.
Yeah, that's fine. I'll accept that as part of the main motion.
Okay.
Yeah. The next one is the.
We're going to vote on that. Okay. All those in favor for Colleen's Super Bowl trip? Right? 500. We'll just travel
the
same time as the Super Bowl, not actually to it. All right. I know.
Don't start rumors.
Please strike that from the record.
other one is is the NEPA. It's actually the NEPA legislative rally. The APPA is going on at the same time, and that's a whole conference. I'm not asking to go to that or pay that kind of money. The NEPA legislative rally is I go from each of the legislative buildings and sit outside their office until they will speak to me for 2 minutes, and I go in and we pitch our municipal thing. So it's actually just 2.5 days of sitting outside everyone's office and going in and speaking on behalf of all of the municipals, because they do speak to the ISO, they do speak to the IOUs, and no one seems to represent us. So we go down in force and we split up so that we have 2 or 3 people that get to meet with almost everybody that's responsible for this area and throughout New England.
How does it organize? How do you organize that group to go down and divide
NEPA
up?
NEPA does.
NEPA does it.
Well,
okay.
They ask who's going,
yeah.
And then they may send me to ones that actually represent Reading or anybody in our service territory. And if there isn't anybody available for a different municipal, I may go talk on their behalf.
Mm-hmm.
So they split us up and they keep us going for 2.5 days.
Hmm. Interesting.
Sherwin does something similar during their legislative conference.
The HR industry that we're in. Yeah.
But it's very valuable because you do get to.
Did you do it, Tom, before?
I did.
Yeah.
You only get a few minutes.
Yeah.
You may not get the senator.
You don't even.
Right.
Sometimes you don't get the senator. You just get their assistant.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. But they're very good too. And we've written letters. We've gotten a lot across. I think what's happened today is a show that they're listening to us.
That's true.
The legislation.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Moving the ball. That's great. All right. So motion. Yeah.
Yeah. Move that the board of commissioners approve Ms. O'Brien's travel to and attendance at the APPA legislative rally in Washington, D.C. from February 24th to February 28th, 2019.
Second. Okay, second. All right.
Just one discussion?
Yeah, discussion.
Do you think this may get affected by the government shutdown?
It could. It could.
I'll have plenty of time to see.
I mean, I'll let you know if it gets canceled.
Yeah. That's true. It is about a month away.
Yeah,
so.
It could happen.
No, it's NEPA.
Okay. It's NEPA.
Yeah.
We need to vote on it.
We'll need to vote.
Yeah, all those in favor. 500. All right. And now we have the power supply report. Chuck's coming back up. Chris, you don't have to hang around if you don't want to. It's up to Colleen, of course. So.
I'm good. You guys are good. I think we're good. Thank you for
yep.
saying
thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Chris.
Good evening again.
Mm-hmm. Welcome
to the
back.
Power supply report. Everything is good. Questions?
I liked your presentation. Very good.
If you take a look at the lines, we've actually been tracking fairly well over the course of the year. The differential is hanging right around zero, so we're tracking very well, and we're tracking against the budget, which means that the costs that we are charging are what we expected to charge. So it has been a rather uneventful period. We only have 1 month left to go in the year, and December also did not have anything eventful. So the next time I come up, it's going to be another hi, it's great, any questions report.
Okay, good. That's it. I like it.
Thank you.
That is good, Chuck. We like really tight presentations. It's awesome. Wendy is not presenting.
Wendy is stuck in Florida from the storm. So we were hoping she was back tonight, but she didn't get back in time.
Yeah. I get caught up in the same travels. Logan's been really bad this week.
I had no problem, too.
I think she went on a cruise.
You get back okay?
Yeah, I traveled back from Tampa. Easy.
All right, Hamid. Engineering.
Plane took off only 5 minutes delay.
In operations.
Yeah.
Welcome, Hamid.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, absolutely.
For sure.
I don't know if Chuck feels about that.
Chuck has only one
slide.
Well, he gets extra credit.
For one slide, and I'll be done.
Hey, message there.
Yes. Make your best slide. All right, let's go to the last one. All right, I'll be quick. Okay, good evening. Giving you a report for the month of January. Actually, this report is including, you know, it's up to date, the stuff, including the month of December. So the first slide talks about the pole line upgrade. That project is completed on Woburn Street. That's part of our long-term plan for reliability. That's completed. The remote racking device installed at Station 3. This is for safety of the workers when they rack out the breakers or the switch gear. So that's completed. The Martin's Landing, this is an ongoing project, 450 residential condominiums, and you know the builder, you know, they do it in phases. So phase one is completed. Now we're getting into phase two, which is a good thing. The 4W5, 4W12 getaways, we're trying to remove some of the underground getaways out of the station four to increase the ratings of the cables. So that's going to give us more ampacity tolerance. So during the switching in here, you know, we have more. So that's this was the creative way to do that engineers they came up with in order to raise the ratings and correct some of the problems at station four. The 3W13 riser, that this is the riser right outside the station three on Chestnut Street. What happened with the motor vehicle accident that was that actually destroyed the entire, you know, riser, and the crews that are working on it now. I believe it's going to be done by next week, so we should have everything back to normal. The next slide are the maintenance programs, and you know the age transformer replacements. You know that's an ongoing program. We're going to be doing a study to see that, you know, really what is the threshold. You know, so far we've done a study in house, and you know, manufacturer recommendations are any transformers that are over 25 years old, they should be replaced out of the system. We've got about 1,600 of those that we need to deal with. But we're going to perform a study because it's going to be costly and see over what period of time, you know, we should, you know, put it in the budget and take care of that. So it's very costly. It could cost anywhere between $8 to $10 million. So that's something that, and I'm, thank you for John for mentioning that, because that's a big ticket item that
is
we've been talking about it, and you know it keeps coming back. The pole inspection program, we have inspected 256 poles in 2018 with 229 pole transfers completed, so we're right at them. And part of the issue, part of the these pole inspections are in Reading custodial areas. So Colin and I, we've had discussions to maybe expand the program to the Verizon set, because they don't test their poles. So we're thinking about that, and you know, just for safety. Because we've been waiting for them to get that done, and nothing has been done. Yes, sir.
Really good pole.
Yeah.
Yeah. Question.
Yeah.
Yes.
The other night at the select board's meeting,
right,
there was discussion about, they actually were discussing the 40B projects going in Wakefield.
Mm-hmm.
And there was discussion about the pole at the corner of Hopkins and South Street,
mm-hmm,
that is constantly getting knocked down, the residents were saying. I don't know if that's one of ours. Can we maybe look into that?
And what, in Reading?
It's
Reading, yes. That's our custodial area.
Yeah, that pole, they're saying, getting knocked down on a regular basis.
We know that. I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah, we've had a couple of one thing, I'll talk to DPW director. Maybe we can put the guardrail or something, you know, there. But it's a very tough corner.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've seen it or not. It's very tough.
They were saying big trucks are coming around that corner,
yeah,
just knocking that
always
pole right down.
Always taking that turn, unfortunately.
Yeah.
You know, we've got a pole right at the intersection, yes.
Okay.
It's carrying the major load in down to southern portion.
Okay.
All right, so, I made a note of it, and I'll look into that.
It's our pole?
Yes.
It is, yeah.
Yeah.
You know it well, because you've been there a lot. It sounds your cruise has to go there.
Back, I know where you're talking about. That's a tough corner.
Schedule
that.
Very good.
For upgrade.
inspection of the feeders. We, as you know, we inspect the feeders routinely, quarterly, just looking continuously for any signs of trouble or, you know, possible potential failures. And if we see them, we correct them immediately. Infrared scan, we do that monthly. We don't have to do it monthly. Most utilities, they do that like quarterly and or maybe once a year. We do that monthly at the substations and quarterly at the parks. So we haven't found any hot spots yet. The manhole inspection is ongoing. Porcelain cutout replacements, that's ongoing as we're getting into the development and reconstructions of the areas for reliability enhancements. The next slide is giving you a basically snapshot since we started this pole inspection program. The first year we had like about 33% failure, and you see that it's been going on down, but this is only in Reading custodial area. We got about 6,000 poles, but we got 17,800 something poles. I know that example, approximately 17,000, 18,000 poles in the system. Majority are in Verizon's custodial area. So you could see that, you know, that's a big undertaking in order to test all of them and trying to do that. It's going to take us years. But these are sorted by age, basically. We pick the worst areas, and then you see that the numbers are going down. The numbers of the poles that they failed or needed to be replaced. So that's so much for that. And the next one is a double, that could give you the snapshot of the double poles in different community, Linfield, Reading, North Reading, and Wilmington. As you could see that, you know, most of those, we don't have much to transfer. And the pole butts, we remove in North Reading and half the Reading, that's our custodial area. The other communities are basically Verizon's custodial area. And once everybody's transferred, then, you know, then the person who, or the utility that has the custodial area, would remove the pole butts out of the ground.
I mean, so yes. Verizon doesn't do any testing on their poles, do you know? Or do they do?
They
do
it until
the pole falls down.
Yeah.
And then they're
well, unfortunately, we talked, Colin and I, we talked to them. What they do, not really as aggressive as we are doing it. They just do the inspections and light inspections that, you know, it's not, to us, it's not acceptable.
Can I add? So when they get a work order that has to do with a particular pole, they just do a visual inspection.
Right.
And we do a
core inspection, right?
Core inspection. And so we're going to start coring their, I mean, we own the poles too, but in their custodial area, we won't be able to charge them. It would be a union issue on if they were to pay us. But because we're an owner, we're gonna test them anyways, just for public safety.
Hmm. Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, we got plans for that. So hopefully, you know, next year we're gonna get started, or this year maybe, depending if how this situation goes. All right. The next slide, it's giving you the reliability indices. This is basically showing the health of the system. SAID, KD, and SAIFI, they're all, you know, they're good numbers. You know, we've been doing really great with all the major improvements that we've done. The only thing that it's gone, we're well below regional and national averages for SAID and KD. SAID stands for System Average Interruption Duration, and KD is Customer Average Interruption Durations, which were well below those numbers. These are good numbers. The safety, unfortunately, we passed a little bit over the national average.
Wait, what does that one stand for?
The safety is System Average Interruption Frequency, the frequency of the outages. So the way that you know you measure the health of the system is the duration of the outages and the frequency of outages. These are the pockets of outages that caused either by motor vehicle accidents or the tree incidents or the stuff that you know, well, you have little pockets of outages all over. These are not really major.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these are the, you know, services out when the, you know, during the storms, you know, they take that. So we take everything into account, and that's why that number gone up. And it's, you know, it's kind of normal for the utility of our size during the course of the year. numbers actually we report to APPA. APPA has a program called electronic reliability tracker. So we report our numbers, and what they do, they compare the regional, which is Northeast region, and also the national overall to see what how we do compared to the entire, you know, municipals in the municipal in the USA. And then they publish those numbers, and they tell us whether we're doing good or bad. Last year, we got the award, if you recall, we mentioned that, you know, for the reliability, for the numbers that we had. But I don't want it, you know, people thinking that, you know, we are out of the woods. With all the problems that, you know, we've identified, and we still got lots of improvements to make. So because we've done good in 1 year, it doesn't mean that, you know, well, we are out of the woods and, you know, we are okay, and therefore we could stop the maintenance and doing stuff like that. We still got plenty maintenance work to do. And, you know, that just you see what you see. It's just, you know, icing on the cake. So you got more in-depth, you know, analysis being done. And as John mentioned, we keep continuing spending money and putting money back into infrastructure to increase the plant value, which is good.
You're like Bill Belichick, you can't get overconfident. You
exactly.
Maintain the system. Improve all the time.
I'm the Tom Brady.
Right.
For the maintenance only. All right. So these are the indices you saw that. Okay, one outage we had, let me, while we're on the outages, the significant outages that we had in the month of December, we had 26 outages overall. These are all, that's when we had all those rain and, you know, the trees coming down and stuff like that. So we got 26 outages in the month of December. We had only four outages, and the longest outage was on Chestnut Street, North Reading, that we had a motor vehicle accident. Okay, that same one, 3W13, that I was talking about, that motor vehicle, you know, unfortunately hit the, right at the beginning of the feeder where, you know, took the underground, everything uprooted. So the last outage that we had in month of January, so I might as well give you that, that was another motor vehicle accident on Elm Street. In North Reading, which took out 1,270 customers. And, you know, unfortunately, these motor vehicle accidents, you know, they when the pole gets hit, they make heavy damages. And tonight, just for your information, we have only three outages, two single outages, 235 Summer Street in Reading and 33 Bracier Way in North Reading. We also have one major outage at 201 Lowell Street at Textron and 207 Lowell Street. The guys, they texted me the picture. Basically, the tree fell on the wires and snapped top of the pole. So they're setting the pole right now, and, you know, they have to de-energize it so they can move everything from the broken pole to the new pole. So these are the updates for now.
Just from this morning, the wind
from
this afternoon.
This afternoon, yeah. Right, the wind and everything that happened. The last slide, it shows you basically the outages and the causes of the outages, and you could see that, you know, the trees are going up, getting pretty much closer to the 5 years average. The blue color of the 5 years averages, the red it was basically for 2018, how we did. So you see that the highest numbers are wildlife, trees, and motor vehicle accident, we passed, you know, the 5 years average. And also, we had some other outages too, the other and that category, two of them. I guess the last time I mentioned, the balloon, the real estate agent's balloon wrapped around the wires. So that caused an outage.
Wait until the drones, Amazon's drones start hitting.
That's right. That would be another one. So that concludes my report for tonight.
Thank you. Any questions for Hamid?
If you have any questions, by all means.
Comments? Thank you, Hamid.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
All right. Okay, we're going to our general discussion here. We have our board meetings coming up, February 21st, Thursday, and also March 21st. Any concerns for anybody's calendar on those dates?
Which ones again?
It's February 21st, our next board meeting.
Yep, that's fine.
And then March 21st. I think both February?
Let's see. Yeah, February 20th.
Is that school vacation week?
First.
Yes.
Yeah, I might have to dial in remotely on that February.
Well, why don't we should we move it?
Well,
huh?
where would you move it to?
The 28th.
This week.
Florida.
Previous week, maybe.
That's Valentine's Day.
Yeah, that's not going to work. I will be in Florida. So, but we'll keep it where it is, and I'll just call in.
That's tough, though, when you call in, though. It's very disjointed.
Vacation?
I think school vacation week is the 18th. Is that true?
I believe so, yes.
It is? You think it is?
Yeah. We dealt with this on our, we were discussing it.
You discussed the same thing. Did you move it,
yeah,
or did you keep it?
We moved ours. I believe it's the 13th.
You went early.
Yeah, we're going early.
You want to do the 14th?
It's Valentine's Day.
Is that the best?
So the 13th.
How about the 28th?
28th?
I should be there.
What do you guys think?
We can't do the 28th either.
28th feels like it's
too far away.
Too far.
Well, we're waiting for comments.
Yeah, that would work for me. The 12th.
Right, waiting for comments from the CAB. So.
Right. Oh, right.
Yeah.
It's the day after. Yeah.
You guys can celebrate Valentine's Day.
Do the 13th after the cab.
Yeah.
We could come right in after them on the 13th.
Yeah, we start early. So
they start early.
So why don't we do that?
Yeah.
One way we can say hello to you guys on the way out.
Okay.
That works
okay.
For me.
What time do you meet?
6:30.
John,
are you still traveling then?
No, 6:30 will be fine.
So we won't come at 6:30. You start at 6:30.
Oh,
I start at 6:30.
Oh, you're coming for that.
I'm coming for that.
We'll wrap it up by the time you guys start.
So save you.
So 7:30. We all you all plenty of time.
Awesome.
All right. I think the 13th it is, right?
Yep.
Okay.
7:30.
7:30.
Okay.
Yeah.
13th.
Yep. Chuck's coming back.
Oh, Chuck. Unannounced. What do you got?
Well, if the commission will indulge me and
yes,
you have your calendars out, we do have some community relations activities going up.
Okay.
We have a contest in schools each year. The students are presented with a video themed towards electric safety,
mm-hmm,
and they create artworks within the
mm-hmm
classes,
right,
which are then
mm-hmm
posted and judged. Tuesday, February 5th at 6:30 p.m., Reading and Linfield awards will be presented, and the snow date for that is February 7th.
Mm-hmm.
That's Reading and Linfield?
That's Reading and Linfield. And Tuesday.
What time is that?
6:30 p.m.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll be there for that.
Tuesday, February 12th,
right,
again at 6:30, will be Wilmington and North Reading. Snow date for that is February 14th.
Can somebody do that one?
Yeah. I mean,
I can probably be there for that.
Joyce had sent this out previously. I've already got it in my calendar.
Yeah. So you already got both dates?
I already got both. All the dates are already in my calendar.
All right. Right. So
the first one I can't make, but the second I can.
Okay.
I can do the first one. I can't do the second one.
Right. Well, I'll be there for both, so whatever.
That's right here.
Whatever's needed.
Well, you have another event, too? Or is that
the other event, and this is more a notice than anything else, we do a Save Energy and Money program where we have informational sessions for new ratepayers and those who would like a refresh. Those are being scheduled for March. We will have some specifics posted to the RMLD website once the schedule is complete and we have the agendas finalized for those. The program covers energy efficiency programs, rebates, home energy assessments, shred the peak, conservation tips, etc. So these are public forums and letting you know that those are available.
Are they held here, Chuck?
I'm sorry?
Are they held here at our building?
I am not sure where they are.
We've had them other places.
They moved to,
yeah.
There is an outreach effort to try and do these in the communities themselves rather than here. So
right,
where these will be scheduled, I don't know at this point.
Yeah,
but,
that's good.
Great.
I'm really looking forward to the art award. Usually we get to say a few words, you know, give the awards, and I always tell some jokes about, like, what's the favorite band of RMLD, and it's AC/DC or Electric Light Orchestra. And I was telling my son. I was telling my son that today. So he goes, and I've used it the last couple of years. He goes, Dad, that's so lazy doing the same joke. So I gotta have to. No, I can't use that. I'm gonna have to freshen up.
You need some jokes that are more current.
That's good.
Which one do you prefer for CPR? Staying Alive or Another One Bites the Dust?
All right, we're moving on. All right, the cab. We don't have dates on these yet. Oh, you have John's.
We have John's. Do we have the March one, too? Do you have your March date?
No.
Okay, so I'll wait to hear that from you. And
say thank you also to Karen for coming and sitting so patiently through this.
Oh, hi, Karen.
How are you?
From FinCom. Please come and just.
Okay. Thank you.
The people can't see the report unless you're at the mic. Okay.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you. Introducing yourself.
Thank you. Okay. And any other comments from the commissioners?
Yes.
There's a suggestion regarding the town payment next steps. Since the days and weeks fly by, I don't have a hard recommendation that we should slot some time to map out what we want to do in terms of addressing the formula and any other things that we want to do and put a timeline together.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. Maybe we should just put that in the February agenda to start talking about that. Yeah. I know, Colleen, you have some things in motion. You'll probably want to, you might have some more updates for us on recommendations you have as well. So.
On the payment?
Yeah.
Next steps.
Next steps. To do the research we need to do.
Absolutely.
You know, because 2 years, like you said, Tom, 2 years can fly by, as we know. For 2 years.
Yep.
Okay. Good. And other comments from anybody, including you, George?
Thank you.
One quick one that I forgot to mention. So I do my annual, sometimes semi-annual update with all the towns. We just met with Wilmington. George was there, met with the town manager first, met with the selectmen, did our presentation. I thought it went well.
Very well.
Very informative. We have North Reading next Monday night. We had Linfield on the 7th, but it got canceled. It's getting rescheduled for March. And then because I just did town meeting in Reading, we'll probably wait another month or so. I'm working with the town manager on that and get back to the Reading selectmen. So it's going well, and I'll keep you updated.
Okay. Excellent. Very good. Great. Okay. Any other? We're good? All right. We'd like to make a motion to go to executive session.
Do we have things for executive session?
Second. We do.
Oh, okay. Wait a minute. I'm making motion of these first.
I think no.
Don't steal his thunder, John. He likes reading this thing.
Take it back.
Second, anyway. Move that the Board of Commissioners go into executive session to consider the purchase of real property and discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Second.
Okay.
Gotcha.
I said that, didn't I?
I think I heard him say it. He whispered it. We now have heard it.
Right.
Okay, requires a roll call vote. Mr. Hennessy, aye.
Tom O'Rourke, aye.
Talbot, aye.
Mr. Snapback, aye.
Thank you, George.
Thank you.
Good night.
Very good.
All right.